Hey, this is Sean. What's going on? Every once in a while, I go on the Google to look for book reviews on obscure books that no one's ever heard of, but I've read and I liked. Once in a blue moon, someone comes up with a review, and I like to listen to them because I pick books that are. You have to read them a couple times before you're like, aha, now I get it, you know? So it's fun watching, or maybe not fun, but it's interesting to see how other people react to books that you have to read a second time to understand. Because that's the way they're intended to be read. So this guy's going to do a review of the fifth head of Cerberus. See how he likes it.
There, and welcome to another episode of News from the Gelding. Okay, so we're going to be reviewing another book today. This one is Gene Wolfe's The Fifth Head of Cerberus. Now, this is another dip into the Masterworks collection. I bought three of them recently and I'm just reading through them. This is the second one. So I'm going to attempt a review of it.
He says free instead of three. By the way, I used to have brushes. I used to be an artist. I want to see the painting that's behind him though.
There will be some spoilers, I imagine. I haven't prepared at all for this, other than, well, bugger all, actually. So it's probably going to be a bit crap. But anyway, it's my take on it. And there we are. The one bit of preparation I have done is I just dipped into the Amazon review page just to see what other people thought of it, because my thoughts on it were slightly confused.
I'm afraid to look at reviews on Amazon.
Shall we say. Okay, so we've got a fairly divisive book here, I would say. We've got a spread of reviews from the 5-star rating of 58% all the way down. We've got 4 stars, 3 stars, all the way down to 1 star. The funniest review I read was a 1-star review, which went, "This book has graphic sexual content in the first chapter. Sexual content with an insect. The book is too long. There's also a graphic scene with torture. I would never recommend this book to anyone." Now, whoever wrote that review has read the wrong book, because there's absolutely no insect sex scenes. That may have elevated its worth to me.
Yeah, I don't know about any insect sex scene. I have to read that book again. Gosh.
Slightly. I'm not saying that I didn't like this book, but there are some problems, at least to me. We go to the 5-star reviews. There's people.
I like how he says there are some problems. Only some?
Calling it a masterpiece, a work of genius, that kind of thing. And so my.
Well. It was written a long time ago, and so compared to what's written now that you find in Barnes & Noble, you know, stuff like Ender's Game, you know, that kind of stuff. Yeah. This book's written by a genius, a mastermind.
Alarm bells start ringing in my head that I've obviously missed something that's glaringly obvious to perhaps more cultured, more intellectual readers than myself. That's high.
I hope he's not referring to me.
Highly possible, because I'm not that clever. But I've read a good deal of science fiction.
I like this guy's presence. I'm going to have to subscribe to his YouTube channel, because he's no nonsense. He's humble. He's all the things that you like on a channel that you subscribe to. So far, after 2 minutes of watching,
in the past and lots of other things, quite complicated and deep readings of things. But this one had me slightly baffled. So anyway, all right, we've got a.
Truth be told. I mentioned this before. I use the audiobook of this novel to go to sleep with. And sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and the computer's going through the scary parts of the book, and then I can't fall back asleep. But last night I did a listen to, and I usually fall asleep halfway through the first story in the book, and then I wake up usually at the end of the second story in the book. So only my subconscious would remember parts of the book like that. Other parts of the book, hopefully he'll talk about the parts I remembered because I was awake during those scenes.
I'll just say it's composed of three novellas, and the book, the meat and veg of the story are sprinkled around these three apparently disparate stories. I'll read the blurb just to give you an idea of what we're dealing with here. On the twin colony planets of Saint Anne and Saint Croix, civilization is a colorful mix of the archaic and the futuristic, with slavery and advanced science coexisting. The shape-shifting alien inhabitants of St. Anne were exterminated by the colonists, but some believe that instead they killed the humans and adopted their identity. In three interlocking tales, the secrets of this strange society are gradually unraveled. The secrets may be unraveled, but it's done in a very subtle way.
Yeah, the book is a setting book. If you're a role player and you're looking for a game setting, that's the book to use. It's in the future. Humans have left Earth. You know, a colonist left Earth, went to this twin planet system. And it's mostly French, so the people speak French. The towns are named after French places on one of the worlds. And then the other world, no one really goes to because no one's heard back from the colonists that landed on that planet. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Perhaps non-existent way, but a number of the five-star reviews I read, they said that once they'd finished reading the book, they started reading it again for the pure joy of it, and also to try and...
Yeah, you like some of the characters, you want to read, now what happened to that character again? Because that was neat. It was like, it's like a movie done in one shot, and it's over, and you're like, what did I just watch? And how come it's over? Why? There's no ending to this? So you go and rewind the VHS, and you watch it again. Because it does. There's no ending. It's just a setting book. So there's no beginning, there's no end to the book.
Extracts like some more information regarding what the whole thing's about. So one reading...
The setting is told by the characters in the book. So you're seeing the setting through their eyes. And I'll say this one thing. Gene Wolfe, his books were written using an unreliable narrator. That was the style of his writing. So the characters telling you the story, basically, they're very unreliable at narration. Also, the characters tend to be existing at a time long after the settings were established. So the characters don't know their history. They don't know where stuff came from. They don't quite understand things in their world. To them, it's just ancient stuff. To us, that would be, oh, they're talking about the Sears Tower in Chicago. But to them, they don't know what it is because it's in the future and everything's falling apart, built over. That's ancient history to them. No one cares. Just like today, you know, today people don't care what was going on in their town, you know, just 300 years before. No one cares. They build over it. The highways get plowed right through all that stuff. No one cares what was there 300 years ago. So the characters, they'll when they're telling the reader stuff, you know, where they're walking through, they're walking around something and they see it in their mind. They think about it as they walk around the item. They do a really lousy narration description of what they just walked around. So you don't realize what it is they're walking around until your second read. And then you're like, oh, now I get it, you know. Because you see the rest of the setting later on in the book. It's a slow burn reveal.
Evidently isn't enough. But I won't be reading it again to try to solve the mystery of what the book's about, because you get to the last...
Oh, no, that's too bad. Well, at least, okay, I'm going to have to contact this guy and just tell him, hey, just download the audiobook from YouTube and just listen to it. Then you don't have to read it over again. Just listen to it.
Last page, and at this point, I was more or less certain that no conclusions were going to be drawn. And I wasn't disappointed. There was absolutely none. In fact, the last paragraph was so bewilderingly obtuse that I almost chucked the fucking book out the window. But that said, I did enjoy it, and I'll explain why. The writing itself is good. It's poetic at times, nicely descriptive. And it paints an interesting portrait of these two very different worlds. The first story, now the spoilers are going to be abounding here because I don't know what to talk about and what not.
Okay, maybe you should stop this.
There's no way I can spoil it entirely.
Maybe you should stop the video now if he's going to spoil it. Or hang on. Maybe you want to know about it before you read it so that when you do read it, you'll know what all the stuff is that we're confused about the first time you read it.
Because it's more or less impossible. Even if you read the thing a few hundred times, you may not glean everything that the author...
That's true. Each time I listen to the audiobook, there's one more thing I'm like, what?
No way. ...intended. The first story, the first novella, is called The Fifth Head of Cerberus. And it's about a very, it's set on one of these twin worlds, Saint Croix, I think it is. Yeah. I kept getting confused about which planet was which, but this one has a lot of, it's the more high technologically advanced world, shall we say, with cutting edge science, but set within the kind of ruins of a post-colonial French settlement, so quite grand buildings. So there's quite a strange mixture there. So this is one of the clues right off the bat to what's going on. The blurb is suggesting that the colonists were all killed at some point and shapeshifters took their place. Now, this is the first little clue that I considered. But anyway, I'll talk about that later. I'll probably forget about it. And we follow two young boys, mostly from the perspective of one of them. And as we later discover, they are clones of who they discover to be their father, who is a kind of is a scientist or a geneticist, perhaps, and also a brothel owner. Now, that was a very strange thing to come to deal to terms with. I thought, what the hell's going on here? so that there's probably a clue there as to something. Someone could perhaps explain to me the significance there. So this father figure, who is actually the same person as these two boys.
Gene Wolfe is also known for writing stories that come off as fever dreams. When you have a fever and you have that same dream over and over and over again, that's how some of his stories come across. So when you read about a scientist who does cloning and he runs a prostitution ring of some sort, then it's like, what? That's what you would dream about if you had a fever.
Proceeds to do experiments on them in terms of trying to work out what they're thinking about, or in terms of their identity, perhaps, what they're dreaming about, what they think about things. quite cruel, really. That was quite an unsettling part of it. It follows them up to a certain point in their lives, and the story concludes with the fact that the boy that you follow mostly is imprisoned, I think for the murder of his father, this cruel scientist. Some of his time spent in prison and coming back out to run the brothel again. That's the first story. The second one takes a quite a turn, really. So the second one's called A Story by John V. Marsh. Now, the connection here between these two stories is this chap, John V. Marsh, who we meet briefly in the first story, who is an anthropologist from Earth, who has come to the brothel to perhaps savor the delights of the brothel, but also to seek out another famous anthropologist that lives there, the sister, or I think it's the sister of the mad scientist. I don't fucking remember.
Yeah, I want to say it's the aunt, the kid's aunt or something. It's like reading a book and no two people have the same recollection of what happened in the book.
But she has this idea, this theory, that the aliens killed all the original settlers and that everyone is actually aliens. They just don't know it. They've become, these shape-shifting aliens have become them. There's an interesting, so right off the bat, we know what the thing's dealing with when it gets to that point. But so yeah, this story is apparently written by this chap who perhaps favors this idea. Now,
Yeah, so you're reading a book that's written by someone else. So there's two layers you're going through. You're going through the author's layer, and then you're going through the character's layer. It's interesting because you get to see the many quirks that the character has when he's writing the story. And then the author has to write it in such a way so that you don't see all the clues right away that are in the character's book that he's writing. He's got this journal that he's been writing in during the book. So it's kind of blurred. You don't know if you're still reading from the character's book or if the author of the book is narrating something. It's very clever how it's done. And if you don't know that's going on, then yeah, you're totally lost.
Now, this story, although fictional apparently, is definitely based on an experience of some kind. And it's dealing with the original inhabitants of Saint Anne, so the original aliens, the aborigines of that planet. A very, very strange story indeed. Quite hard to read, but also quite interesting for that change of pace and
Yeah, because in the second, well, also in the first story, but mostly in the second story, the characters use their own vocabulary. And if you don't understand what those words mean, you're like, what? That's why you have these people on Amazon that sell the Codex books of Gene Wolfe's novels to that have it's they're like encyclopedias or dictionaries of all the words used in all of his books, so you know what the heck people are talking about. Because in the future, people talk differently and they have words that we just don't know yet. Some words you just never figure out. You only the author is going to know what that means, unfortunately. But it's part of the mystery of the book. You don't know all the things. You don't have all the pieces to the puzzle. Nothing's lined up like ducks. Easy for you, easy peasy for you to understand. So there's always going to be something you go, huh, what was that? Like one part I like is when in the second book they say something like, Sister Rising. they say that a lot, or sister setting, and you don't know what the hell they're talking about. Sister rising, sister setting. And later on, you find out what they're talking about. I think in the third book, you realize, oh, what they were saying in the second book, when they say sister rising, they're talking about the time of day. Because the sister planet rises and sets. And I thought that was really cool. And some of the savages, the barbaric tribes, they tell time by where their sister planet is in the sky.
Being told through the eyes of an alien. So there's language there that you might associate with any native or aboriginal ancient civilization, with calling things by their names. People don't have names as such. They call them like...
They don't have names. Yeah, in Gene Wolfe stories, his characters have names like Running with Scissors. Right, I think in the fifth head of Cerberus, one of the characters' names is Pink Lily. Pink Lily Small Fingers. Or Pink Lily Tiny Fingers. Something like that. That's their name. So, I wouldn't get too carried away with the names of characters, as long as you know whose name goes with what character in the story. Then you're good to go.
I don't know, Steep Rock or... you get the idea. I've forgotten all the bloody names, but so that was interesting. And again, there's clues about shape-shifting, perhaps, because it follows two boys. And whilst they're called different things, their roles are kind of interchangeable. And by the end, you don't know who's who. So again, we're dealing with questions of identity.
Yeah, when someone gets taken over by one of the mimics, the mimic then continues telling the story from where the character left off. Because now that alien has taken over the character. And you don't know that they've been taken over. And all of a sudden you're wondering, why is this text read differently than in the previous pages? What happened there? And you're like, huh? Because you don't know that the character just got taken over by one of the aliens.
Uncertainty prevails throughout this book. The last novella is called simply VRT, and this is a collection of journals, again pertaining to this chap Marsh, who the journals detail his exploration of the Saint Anne, trying to work out whether these aboriginals still exist in present day. But at the same time,
also, you don't know how much time has elapsed between each story. Sometimes you don't know how much time has elapsed within a story, from one page to the next. Because in the third book, the third story, one of the characters ends up in prison, and he's going to be what is it called? Interrogated. He's being interrogated through most of the book, but you don't know how, when did he get arrested? How long has he been in prison before the story began? And you're not even sure if that character is the same character from the previous books, because he's acting a little bit different. You don't know why he's acting different.
He's been incarcerated in prison on the other planet, Saint Croix. And he's being interrogated. So it switches between his ruminations of his current imprisonment, what he was doing on the other planet, his discoveries, perhaps, and also an officer who's reading the journals and deciding the fate of this chap. Very, very... It's all over the place, that last chapter.
It's all over. It is all. They cannot make a movie of this book.
I had the most I enjoyed the first two stories the most. The third one was very confusing and at times didn't make sense. But anyway, the blurb is giving you a good indication of what's going on here. We never know entirely anything. It's all up in the air. It's up for you to determine.
You get to pick what it was about that you just read.
What's going on? But there's lots of clues throughout. I was aware of certain clues after having read the blurb and having a modicum of an idea of what the thing was about. But I'm sure there's far more. There's symbolism and multi-layered ideas here that you can spend half your life thinking about. I personally like to pick up a book, read it, and get nice ideas going around in my head. This one let me think
quite. Yeah, it's way different than the Foundation series where you're reading a long-ass book about some 1950s style characters, all, you know, mostly white people, and they're on a spaceship drinking coffee and smoking pipes and discussing their plans to travel across the galaxy to fix the empire that's in shambles all around them. And they just talk. They talk briefly for a few minutes while they're sipping their coffee and eating their canned rations from the spaceship they're on. And then they cut to the next scene 300 years later, and there's a different group of people, and they're continuing on where the other people have left off, trying to fix the empire. It's so simple reading. It's boring as hell. And, you know, people eat that stuff up, you know. Million copies, that kind of thing. But yeah, the fifth head of Cerberus. Anyway. It makes you think. It makes you think in layers. Layers of layers.
Quite a bit about what's going on, but it also frustrated me a great deal. So one of the things was at the beginning, this didn't confuse me, but this is so the fact that this the high technology set in the ruins of the post-colonial French settlement. Everything is kind of run down, but you've got the cutting edge science on one end and crumbling library that's not used on the other. Now this suggests to me that indeed a certain amount of the population are these alien shapeshifters, because they're mimicking humanity but without the thought processes and the drive to seek knowledge in the same respect. So that's why some of it's crumbling and some of it, I don't know, fuck it, I'm rambling already. And this is going to be utter crap, isn't it, this video?
But no, you did good. I think you're doing good.
I'm not going to overly research this. I just read a book and talk about it. It's awful, obviously, but
no, you're talking,
would I
you're
recommend
talking
it to you? Yes, I would. It's worth a
You're talking good about the book. You're talking good. You've done good talking about the book.
Read, but be prepared to be frustrated. But I mean, some of the reviews, people they absolutely fucking loved it and read it perhaps every fucking day. I don't know. you know, certain authors develop a cult around them and.
I don't know if I would read it every day. I listen to the audiobook maybe once a month, or every 5 or 6 weeks I'll listen to the audiobook while I'm doing my computer programming. I have it playing in the background just for noise. Yeah, there probably I'm sure there's the fanatics out there that they want to, I don't know, they'll never make a movie of the book. It cannot be done. Because the movie would reveal right away all all the puzzles, all the questions the viewers would have. Yep. I don't think you can make a movie of a Gene Wolfe book.
You know, people love their work and they find things and they can invest more time in, you know, perusing their various works. I'm not sure I'll be jumping back into his work anytime soon. And I know as people listening to this, well, they probably won't be because I hardly ever get on listening to it. But if they did, they'll be saying, look, you're missing out, old boy. You need to get back into it. There's hidden depths. But the thing is, a story needs to carry you. It needs to carry your...
Yeah, he's right. I mean, this guy's on the ball. Your friends are going to say, oh, you just have to read it a second or third or fourth or fifth time. Well, okay, let's say you do all that. And then you understand more. But then what? Like I said at the beginning, the book is a setting. It's not a story. It's a setting through the eyes of characters. So you're reading a book. You're finding more and more clues. You're going, oh, okay, that makes sense. Oh, I get it. I'm understanding more of the setting. But there's still no story there. That's probably the most frustrating for most people reading the book.
Your attention intrigue you enough to keep reading. It has to be enjoyable to a certain extent. This felt like a chore. towards the end, especially.
Yeah. After a while, you're like, okay, can I get off this railroad now? You know, it's things like that. I want to get off. But no, you hang in there and you stick to it. I've read this far. I'm going to finish this book. God damn it. Yeah. Everyone's been through that who's read the book.
Especially when things don't make sense. And I can't work.
Yeah, you can't put a book down unless you know what it means. It's like, I'm smart enough. Gosh darn it, I'm smart enough. I know how to read. I can read. How come I don't know what's going on in this book? I'm gonna learn how this book, what this book means before I die. You know, that's what keeps you reading it, I suppose. I don't know if Gene Wolfe intended for that. Sucks you in and then tricks you and then you're like, ha ha! Ooh, I must learn the secrets of this book.
Okay, why the hell certain passages were there. It's not that it's been overwritten. It's just that it doesn't.
Yeah, overwritten would be H.P. Lovecraft if you read one of his books. The stories of his books take about maybe 10 minutes to tell, and he stretches it out for a few hours of reading. And you're like, let's see, what? I read, it took me 3 hours to read a 10-minute long story. Because same with Ayn Rand. She's another writer that will, she stretches time. Or slows down time. Because you want to fit in all the narration. And once that starts, the story, there's no story. You're just being narrated stuff. Everything's being described to you in intricate detail. But the characters aren't moving. They're not in motion. No one's saying anything. Time has stopped while you're reading all this narration. That's frustrating for me. I can't read those kinds of books anymore. I don't like books where the story quits while you're reading page after page after page of intricate details about the linens and the fiber of the carpet and the slime oozing from under the doorway. And then the ooze is described infinitely over and over again. Okay, so I get it. There's ooze coming from under the doorway. Then what happens? No, you have to be told more about the hinges of the door, you know, the mind of the person who's watching the ooze come through the door. It's all described down to the brain cells of the character, and there's no story, nothing. There's no action going on. Anyway.
It doesn't follow a logical path in my mind. I folded over one page. I don't know why, so let's have a look. I think See, this is during the first story. Yeah, and it was just a passage that I thought wasn't written very well. So I thought I'll just read it, and I can't even remember it, so I'll just read it. It's probably pointless. This is where he talks to customers, Phaedria said. If he's trying to sell something, he has his people bring them down one at a time so you don't see the others. But you can hear the dogs bark even from way down here. And he took Papa and me upstairs and showed us everything. I don't even know what the hell that was about. I don't know why I followed that. Anyway, there we are. There's a bit of the book there. Right. Okay.
You can't read anything out of context in those books. You have to get like 3 or 4 pages behind it and then read just to get your train of thought in that mindset before you read a sentence. And then you're like, oh, okay. Now I remember what I was thinking about when I first read that line.
There we are, shambles. But yeah, bollocks. Yeah, there we are. Thanks for watching. That's the fifth head of Cerberus. One of the best reviews you will find on YouTube, no doubt.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think you did.
No,
I think you did. You did good.
I've been listening to other things recently on YouTube. People that do it.
I'd say he's passing his sanity role right now.
Very well. You know, they're talking about film and books and going into really deep detail, metaphysics, existential.
Oh, those people, just ignore them. The people that do reviews of 2001 A Space Odyssey, just ignore those people. They're making nothing out of something. Or making something out of nothing? No. The people that explain how the end of 2001 was, just ignore them. They don't know what they're talking about.
Essentialism, all kinds of things. I can't talk about that kind of stuff. All I can do is kind of...
You're the everyday man. You're every man's man.
Adult, kind of what it made me feel, what I understand of a work, based on the experiences I've had in my life, which is really what the majority of us do. I mean, this is a postmodern book. It contains lots of things, lots of questions, but no answers really. We're left to work it out ourselves. Why are my legs moving around so much? I don't know. I think it's because I'm going a bit fucking mad. But anyway, there we are. There's my review. Cheers for watching. See you next time when I'll be reviewing another book. Maybe. Say goodbye, Sabetamo.
That was an utter shambles.
You boy!
That was pretty good. He did better than most. Anyway, talk to you later.